Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. My name is Jill Johnson. I am with the Illinois Farm Families Coalition. Just to start with some quick introductions, I am joined by Gracie, if you wave your hand, Jenny, and Robin. Robin, so the four of us are going to help with some logistics this morning, and then we're also joined this morning and throughout the day with some farmers that are in the audience, Joanne, Alan, and Mike. And then later on today, you will be touring a cattle farm and a dairy farm. And then last but not least, our panelists this morning joining us, Corey Malone, Linda Marcoot, Matt Witte, and Thomas Titus. And so again, thank you for being with us this morning. We're really excited to have a dialogue today about farming and farming practices and really connecting farming with food. And so part of what we're going to be talking about this morning is that food security aspect and how food goes from farm to plate. All of our panelists this morning are experts in food security, biosecurity, but they are all also farmers themselves. So with that, we are going to go ahead and have each one of you introduce yourselves and tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do in agriculture.
Well, we have a community mic, and I'm a little bit taller than your average bear, so this is going to be a little bit more uncomfortable for me, per se. My name's Thomas Titus, and I'm a pig farmer from Elkhart, Illinois. On our farm, we raise corn, soybeans, beef cattle. We've got a few goats, a few chickens that run around. We raise pigs, but the most important thing that we raise on our farm is our children. So we are very generationally involved, and so we're always looking for opportunities to diversify, do our jobs better, and looking for opportunities to bring that next generation back. And so for me, it was the livestock side of our farm that allowed me an opportunity to come back and farm with my wife's family. And so we're always looking for opportunities, and with five young kids running around every day, they're very involved in our farm. And so we're always looking for ways to do our jobs better and looking for ways that we can keep them involved and bring them back whenever we possibly can. So it's an honor to be here with you guys today. Looking forward to discussing some of these topics.
Hello, my name is Matt Witte, and I was born and raised around here. Live now just south of town here near Hayworth, and born and raised near Shirley, which is just south of town here as well. Born and raised on a farm. My dad and my uncle farmed together corn, soybeans, wheat. We also have beef cattle, and where we live at, just north of Hayworth, my wife and I, we also have a flock of sheep as well, so we do that. Back in 06, my parents were looking for a secondary income stream, so they bought Bloomington Meats, processor just south of town here, and we've owned that since then. And that preoccupies the majority of my day now, where I work there and manage the facility with my brother. It's been a very interesting transition, but it's a great way to market our beef cattle and our lambs as well, and just to help the community out by serving a fresh meat product. So very excited to be here.
Hello, my name is Linda Marcoot, and I'm from the Marcoot Jersey Creamery and Marcoot Jersey Farm in Greenville, Illinois, which is about 45 minutes east of the Arch of St. Louis. And our story really began about 180 years ago. And my husband's family immigrated from Switzerland, and the family story goes is they brought some Jersey cattle with us. Jersey cattle is a breed of dairy cows. And when we named the creamery Marcoot Jersey Creamery, we get all kinds of questions. Oh, you're from New Jersey. No, it's a nice state, but I've never been there. So the breed of cattle are Jersey cattle. And so our children are seven generations of Marcoots that's had Jersey cattle in the United States. My husband farmed with his father and his brother until the 1990s, when his father passed away and his brother got a job off the farm. And then in the years 2007 and 8, when the recession hit, it hit the dairy industry terribly hard, including our farm. And at that point in time, I had a 50-some-year-old man who had loved farming. That's all he ever wanted to do in his life. That's all he's ever done in his life. Realize all the skill sets that he's had to develop to be a good farmer. But we didn't know if we could continue or not. We had had four daughters. We encouraged and urged our children to go to college. And at that point in time, they were just finishing their college careers with their master's degrees and all. And lo and behold, much to our terrific surprise, they decided they wanted to come back to the farm. And so we took about a year researching all over the United States, what can we do that will be sustainable. In the year 2000, my husband went to mostly grass-fed, and so the cows feed most of the year on rotational grazing, where we have our pasture divided into 5 to 6 acre plots. And it's very important what grasses that he plants, because realize a lactating cow is very similar to a breastfeeding mother. And the nutrition is paramount. It's very important. A cow will die if the right nutrients are provided. And so we settled on artisan cheeses. Our girls, we realized the commitment that that was taking of our girls. They gave up vacations. They gave up a definition of a normal work week. We don't even know what that means. It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all year round. At any rate, and so we've deeded the creamery and the farm to the girls. We're presently making about 22 different types of cheeses. We built a 360 square foot creamery with a natural aging cave that we age the cheeses in. We also do our own research and development, and the flyers I put on your table is a new product that we're very excited about, Extreme Ice, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that as we go through.
Well, good morning. My name is Corey Malone, and I'm a lecturer of animal science here at Illinois State University. In addition to that, my husband and I, along with my family, raise about 75 beef cattle in Minear, Illinois. It's a small town just about 20 minutes west of here. I can actually one-up your breeds, Jersey breed story, Linda. We raise a breed of cattle called Limousine, so everybody thinks we're in the car business. I don't know a thing about cars, so please don't ask me any car questions. But I would say probably what I enjoy the most about my job and what I get to do is I've grown up with cattle ever since I was born. My mom says I've been in the barn. And now I get to share that side, combine it with the science side, and tell it to my students. And we have a very vast demographic of animal science students here at ISU. So I guess I get to bring them all kind of to the same level. They all come to us with different experience levels. So I really enjoy doing that and telling my ag story.
Thank you. So a little bit more about the Illinois Farm Families Program. As you can see, all of our panelists here are farmers and experts in their field, and they're all really passionate about what they do in agriculture. And so that's really the foundation of the Illinois Farm Families Program. It's a coalition of some agriculture groups in the state, but mostly farmers in this state that really want to share their story, talk about what they do, and be a part of the conversation when we're talking about the food system, health and nutrition, and why that's important all the way through the chain. And so we're going to talk about a variety of different things here this morning, and there will be some time for questions from you all at the end. But first, Thomas, why don't you tell the group a little bit about where your animals end up, the meat from your animals, and how food safety impacts you on your farm?
So on our farm, food safety is extremely important to us because, I mean, as a consumer ourselves, I mean, we're going into the same grocery stores, we're purchasing the same products, we're reaching our arm into those exact same meat cases that every other consumer is. And so whenever we're raising our animals and we're caring for our animals, we're very diligent in how we do that. So all the pigs that we raise are marketed to Farmland Foods or Smithfield. So if you go into a grocery store or supplier that does carry that, if you pick up 100 packages of bacon, there's a pretty high chance one of those packages come from us. So, I mean, whenever you begin to think about that, Even though Farmland or Smithfield is a national brand, it's local farmers. It's the people from, I mean, just down the road in the rural areas that are raising those animals and caring for those animals. And so whenever we begin to think about food safety on our farm and really what that means for us and how we implement that each and every day, we work closely with our veterinarians. We utilize various different types of certification programs from PQA Plus. We also have had a common swine industry audit, just basically displaying our commitment not only to ourselves and making sure that we are doing the right thing, but we're bringing in third parties to make sure and ensure that our consumers, that we're doing the right thing every day. And we're not just the only ones doing it. It's an industry-wide effort to make sure that we are taking the consumers' concerns in highest regard, to make sure that we are producing a safe and wholesome product. Because at the end of the day, I mean, that's what our goal is whenever I go home and I'm reaching into my freezer and I'm pulling out a pork chop, we want to make sure that's as healthy for my family as it is for your guys' as well.
Thank you. And Linda, sort of the same question, but what standards are in place on your farm to make sure that there's safety standards with processing?
Okay, and so food safety in our farm also is very deliberate. And we actually make that as higher priority as making sure that we have a viable financial bottom line. And on our farm, our daughter Beth and my husband take care of the cattle with the help of two young women that we have hired that aspire to further their careers in agriculture. And the creamery, we have about 12 employees. The farm never comes into the creamery until they've showered and changed clothes. We are inspected by the state of Illinois Public Health Department at least quarterly in the creamery. We have our pasteurizer. We have a high temperature, short time pasteurizer that is inspected at least quarterly. We also have a professional licensed calibrator that calibrates it at least quarterly. We are inspected by the FDA whenever they want to come. Presently, they come about every 3 years because we've done quite well and they're very busy people. We also have engaged with the National Sanitation Foundation International. And NSF is one of the most rigorous third-party audits that internationally, actually. And they come in, they inspect every single policy. They inspect every single signed piece of paper. They inspect what we're doing, how we're doing it, processing. We do lab testing of ingredients. We do lab testing in process products and finished products. Our extreme ice, we have two lines of that. We have an extreme ice, which is the flyer I have on your table, but that we have that is for the general public. We have one that is an extreme ice pro that actually has earned the NSF sports nutrition certification, and so it is tested additionally for any athletically banned substances.
Thank you. Matt, as someone that deals directly with meat processing, talk to us about some of the measures that are in place on the meat processing side to make sure that our food is safe.
Well, it's essentially the same amount of thoroughness, except it handles directly with a ready-to-consume product. At our plant, and plants exactly like ours, we have meat inspectors in there every day, 5 days a week. And that's regardless of whether we're harvesting animals that day or we're just processing animals that day. The system that we have in place in the meat processing system, the meat processing industry has actually adopted the HACCP program that you've probably heard of. It's HACCP. It's hazard analysis and critical control points. And it's a two-piece system. First, it's an examination of every system that you have in your facility, whether it be cooking something to fully done or cooking something partially or harvesting the animal or just processing fresh product. It examines every step in that process and it identifies any hazards that might come about in that process. And then you create the critical control points, which are what you would do to prevent that hazard and what you do in case that hazard actually happens. It's not a blind system. It recognizes that things do happen, and you just have to have a plan in order to not only prevent it in the future, but to remedy the situation immediately. And it's a very thorough system. It's reviewed not only by the state, but we've had federal review in the last 2 years as well, where they go through our HACCP to make sure everything's right, and then they actually go through our plant to make sure that we're implementing it, and then actually preventing any of that kind of critical control point violations to occur. We also do testing routinely. We do E. coli, Salmonella, Listeria, all those different things that you've probably heard about in your classes. Not only are we testing, you know, animal carcasses, we're also testing our cooked product and packaging material and stuff like that to make sure that there's no secondary contamination in any way, shape, or form. So.
Excellent. Thank you. Corey, as a farmer and a researcher, you know how important animal care is to farmers and how much time farmers spend making sure that animals are getting the proper treatment, and then how that is important to the food supply. So talk to us a little bit about some of the research that's been done that has maybe changed animal agriculture and really looked at the welfare of the animals.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say that it would seem that research has kind of taken that direction where maybe 50 years ago it was that quantitative data. How quickly can we put weight on an animal? How quickly can we do this? And it's more gone to that social behavior type of research. So how can we most naturally mimic their natural behavior? And I would say that's completely consumer driven. So they might be putting trackers on livestock in a pen and varying how much space they have in that pen, and then tracking exactly where they go in that pen and what is bringing out the most innate behaviors in that particular animal. So welfare, I think, has definitely came to a forefront, and I would say that I would see that to continue in terms of research.
Excellent. And Thomas, you made a comment earlier in a response to a question about PQA, and so I'll start with you, but to all of you on this panel, the agriculture industry has certain quality assurance programs, and Thomas, to start with you, but to any of you that might be involved with something like that, tell us a little bit about what quality assurance programs are and why those are important to both you and to our consumers.
So quality assurance programs are important to us because it provides us with a set of best management practices to implement on our farms to make sure we're caring for our animals to our best ability. And so within our industry, within the pork industry, National Pork Board helps facilitate and provide that educational opportunity. And so on our farm, every single individual, and on most farms, every single individual are PQA plus certified. And so it goes beyond and gives that additional reassurance that we're giving those opportunities or those employees a chance to have some additional education. And additionally, beyond that, we talked a little bit before about site assessments, and that's another program through the National Pork Board where we have our buildings and our facilities, and much like Matt and Ms. Marcoute said about the rigorous activities they have within their individual farms and their businesses. I mean, we have site assessments that are performed on our farm for an annual basis. But additionally, with the Common Swine Industry Audit, which is an extremely rigorous third-party audit that comes in and basically takes a HACCP approach to how we care for animals, and they help us identify some areas. But at the same time, I mean, it's a learning opportunity for all parties involved. And so, I mean, as a farmer, I mean, we're always looking for ways to do our jobs better. And so, I mean, it's programs such as that and site visits and things like that. I mean, that's how we learn to better care for our animals and be able to provide that most nutritious product for our consumers.
Anyone else have any quality assurance comments? Corey?
Yeah, and I will just add on to that. Beef quality assurance training is a voluntary thing, and the Beef Association puts on those training sessions. But what I would say was impressive to me last year, I took some students to be beef quality certified, and I think that there was over 200 producers in that room, and Jill could probably tell you the exact number of producers that got certified. But being a voluntary program and just seeing how many producers want to get certified, want to have the best management practices on their farms was very impressive to me. So,
Okay, Matt, we see sometimes on the news and in the media that there are food recalls. And so tell us a little bit about how a food recall comes to fruition, and then what's done to continue to make sure that food is safe from the point of a recall.
As I mentioned with HACCP, we, as an industry, the meatpacking industry understands that things do happen and recalls happen. And as weird as this sounds, recalls are a good thing because it shows that the system that we have in place is working. It's identifying issues, it's recollecting the product or preventing it from going out into circulation. And the one thing you probably don't notice about recalls is you see on the news they tell you to throw it away or return it and stuff like that. What they don't show you is what happens at that facility after the recall has been initiated. The first thing that happens after a recall is that process at that plant is usually stopped. And they go through that process to find out where the problem occurred and why it occurred. And then the next thing they do is the plant has to find a way to prevent that from ever happening again. It's a very thorough process. When the recall system came out, a lot of plants, they thought it was a death sentence. When you got a recall, no one would ever buy your product again. But a lot of plants have found over the years that a recall is actually a way to ensure that they're giving out the most nutritious and highest quality product that they can, and that consumers, like all of us, understand that it's important that that system occur so that we can be guaranteed that. So it's definitely a very important part of the system, and it's one that will continue to ensure the quality and the safety of the products that we have out there.
Thank you. Linda, talk to us a little bit as someone that's making your own product and involved on the farm, but also has a touch point with consumers, what everyone can do to help consumers learn just exactly how their food is produced and that safety component combined with that.
Okay, well, I would say that make food safety deliberate. Make yourself a food safety expert. There's a world of opportunities on our farm. I am a registered dietitian, and I've for decades, and I have just retired from Illinois Department of Public Health. So I've had a career that has you know, leaned me in that direction. But food safety, decades ago, I was a SurSafe instructor. And we were at a conference, and a workshop was telling how you could add humor to food safety. And it's like the two just really have a little difficulty. But it was a nice little workshop. But there was a woman that sat over on the side, and I noticed when everybody else chuckled at the little jokes, she did not laugh. And at the end, the speaker asked, you know, does anyone have a comment? And she raised her hand. She said, I so appreciate what you're doing because you're trying to help people learn about food safety. But I lost my four-year-old son to a foodborne illness. And, you know, that has resonated in my mind all those years. And I share that with every single employee. We have to make sure all four-year-olds have a fifth birthday. It can't be our fault. And so you have to be deliberate. In our facility, I am a... it's a PCQI, Preventive Control Quality Individual. It's now a regulation with FSMA, the new Food Safety Modernization Act. I'm a lead instructor. I am also a ASQ, American Society of Quality, certified HACCP auditor. So we have our HACCP plan, we have our HARPC plan, they work together. You start getting into it and you're like, you can't stop. It like almost becomes an obsession, and one thing rolls into the next to the next. So the thing that I can say is that for those of us that are on the farm and that are manufacturing food, make it deliberate. There's opportunities, seize them. As far as consumers, please realize all the work that these folks are doing. That why in the world would we do this and not care about what we're, I mean, it's just too hard of work. We don't count our income in hours. You can't count your the hours that you work and say that I make this much an hour. It just doesn't work like that.
Thank you. Anyone else have anything to add there? Okay. We'll go back to the sort of animal care topic again. Thomas, how do you make sure that your animals are healthy, and what do you do to monitor them throughout the day to make sure there's no negative change?
So whenever we're caring for our animals, we work extremely closely with veterinarians. I mean, I have two young daughters, Reagan, who's 8, and Lakin, who'll be turning 5 here in a couple weeks. And so, I mean, whenever they get sick, I mean, we work with our local physician. So, I mean, whenever we do have an animal that gets sick, we work very closely with our veterinarians to make sure that we're providing the best care for those animals. And not only the best care, but we're providing the right care for those animals at the right time and for the right duration. And so whenever we are working for animals, and if we do have a veterinarian visit, I mean, we're walking through, we're looking at ventilation in the building, we're looking at housing, we're looking at feed and nutrition, water sources and things like that, to make sure that we're providing the best environment and the best care for those animals to make sure that we are meeting our needs. And so on our farm, the veterinarian, and on all farms, veterinarians play a very vital role in ensuring the health and of those animals. And so They play a big part of what we do every day, because, I mean, I always say that my young daughters, I mean, have a very vast amount of knowledge for a pair of 4 and 8 year olds with, I mean, what they've experienced and what they see on the farm. And I mean, sometimes we utilize social media, we utilize it relatively heavily to share our farm story and what we do. And so, I mean, sometimes it's asking random questions on Snapchats to my 4 or 8 year old about how we care for our animals, or what we do with sick animals, and how we make sure that we're providing them with the best environment we can. And with consumers today, I mean, they don't have that kind of relationship with where their food comes from and how it's being grown and raised. And I mean, as less than 2% of the population is a farmer, I mean, we feel it's part of our daily duties to make sure that we are reassuring our consumers that we are doing the right things every day. And for us, that's working with our veterinarians. It's those quality assurance programs that we implement on our farms and with our businesses to make sure that we are providing our consumers with the healthiest product we possibly can.
And Thomas, with that, working with your veterinarian, I think everybody in this room recognizes that there are some concerns over antibiotic resistance in livestock production. Can you talk to us a little bit about that, and maybe what protocols are in place to ensure that there aren't residues that end up in the food supply?
Yes, very much so. So whenever we begin to think about antibiotics and how they're utilized on our farm, and so whenever you go to the doctor and you get prescribed, I mean, there's directions on that bottle that say you're supposed to use it for a certain number of days. How many people don't use it for that certain number of days? Probably more than we should count. And whenever we work with our veterinarian, we're very diligent by making sure, and when we talk about antibiotic usage, we're utilizing it at the right time, the right amount, for the right duration, to make sure that we are providing that animal with the best care that we possibly can. And so the safeguards around that, so, I mean, part of the National Pork Board's Pork Quality Assurance Program is making sure that we are very aware of what those withdrawal times are that are mandated by the Food and Drug Administration, to make sure that we are allowing that animal enough time before it does go into the food system or food supply, that those antibiotics are completely removed from their system. And so, I mean, we utilize that to make sure that we're ensuring public health. We're ensuring the health of that product for our families, for your families. And, I mean, the one nice thing about pigs, I mean, we export 1 in every 4 pigs to another country. So it's just not, domestic for us. I mean, it's a global type of a product that we're raising. And so, I mean, we're having to ensure the health and the quality of that product for consumers all across the globe. And so it's something we take very seriously on our farm. And so when we begin to use antibiotics, and that's not always the answer. I mean, sometimes it's adjusting ventilation or nutrition. And one unique thing that we do on our farm is we utilize sometimes a more holistic approach. I mean, we utilize some essential oils, chili powders, oregano's, and we've seen some very positive responses on our farm, where we've seen a reduction in the need or instance for the use of antibiotics. And so, I mean, farmers are always looking for ways to do their jobs better, and our veterinarians are one of those major tools that we have in our toolbox. And so we take those concerns about antibiotic resistance and how they're being utilized extremely seriously on our farm.
Thank you. And Corey, maybe same question for you. What's done on your farm and then here at the university, and especially from a research perspective, to make sure records are kept and, mm-hmm. and you're following those kind of processes?
Yeah, to start, I'll just kind of echo what Thomas was saying in that preventative measures in terms of disease and that kind of thing have really came to a forefront in beef production, and I would assume pork production, but I'll let him speak to that industry. So I tell my students that raising livestock is a lot like raising kids, and that at certain times in their lives they're under more stress or more susceptible to certain diseases and that type of thing. Just like when a kindergartner goes to school and one of them has a snotty nose, the next day they're probably all going to have snotty noses. And it's kind of the same thing with livestock, and we can identify those certain times in their lives when they are more susceptible and really put forth those more preventative measures. He talked about essential oils. We have not used essential oils on our farm yet, but we are able to use certain things like probiotics, essentially to keep feeding their rumen and keep them healthy and that type of thing, so that we can, I'm not going to say eliminate antibiotic usage, but drastically reduce antibiotic usage on our farm. The second part you brought up was technology and record keeping, and if you ask my parents, they might have a different answer for this, but technology is awesome on our farm. We are not the best communicators sometimes, my husband and I, but thanks to technology, we are able to, the minute that we do something to an animal, record it in a program on our smartphones, which are with us all the time. And so not only am I able to access that information, my parents are able to access that, my brother's able to access that, my husband is. So if I forget to maybe give him a call and say, hey, can you do this later tonight? He can pull up our program that we record everything about every animal on our farm, and he can see the notes that I've made about that. So everybody is really diligent as far as keeping records, even if it's something as small as, hey, keep an eye on this one. I noticed maybe it was drooping an ear or something. It can be something really small like that, but we're able to connect. And when we forget to communicate, you know, because husband and wives do that sometimes, we can pull up that program and see things. So,
excellent. Linda, Matt, do you have anything to add to that part of the conversation?
On our farm, we milk our cows by robotics. And so there is a lot of, Corey mentioned, a lot of technology that is, you know, automatic alarms. We set perimeters, and if anything like goes outside or getting approached, an alert before it goes out of the perimeter so we can correct it. We have automatic diversion valve on our robot so that if anything is amiss with the milk, it won't even go into the milk supply. It's diverted and thrown away. We have an automated diversion valve on our HTST pasteurizer. So if that's running at a below 163.8 degrees Fahrenheit, it will automatically divert it so you can't under-pasteurize. So there's a lot of things that we've done that, you know, again, using technology, that is another safeguard. Still visual monitoring, that never goes away, but a lot of technology that enhances that.
Okay.
And I will say that the USDA has varying levels of sizes of meat processing facilities. They have large facilities, they have medium facilities, they have small facilities. My facility is considered very small, which is literally a category. And I've done two residue tests this year so far. And a residue test is simply the inspector chooses an animal, he takes a sample of the muscle, he takes a sample of the kidney, and he takes a sample of the liver. And they examine it for things like antibiotics and varying other medications that have withdrawal times they shouldn't be in the food supply. And so it's a very thorough program that's very rigorously enforced. So,
thank you. And sort of keeping with this technology theme a little bit, Thomas, there's oftentimes you picture a farm in your head, and sometimes we think of pigs outdoors, and sometimes we know they're raised indoors. So can you talk about the difference and why animals are sometimes kept in a building?
So, I mean, whenever we begin to think about the idyllic farm, it's not necessarily like it was 50, 60 years ago. I mean, I grew up on a farm in East Central Illinois, and I mean, we raised pigs outside in dirt lots, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. That's the nice thing about the National Pork Board's Pork Quality Assurance Program. They provide those best management practices to provide the best care for those animals. But today, I raise animals in an environmentally controlled building. That provides me the opportunity to care for our animals, in my opinion, in a better way. We're able to provide a consistent environment for those animals. So whenever it's negative 50 outside, I put on a jacket, Carhartt's, gloves, whenever we're going outside. Those pigs don't have to worry about that. They're in environmentally controlled buildings where we have very technologically advanced monitors to make sure that those conditions inside those buildings are at their optimum level all the time. So, I mean, pigs like it about the relative same conditions as we do all year long, 68 to 70 degrees. My wife is very frustrated in the winter because our pig barns are always much warmer than our houses. But we utilize those barns to protect our animals from the elements and the environment, those varying vast temperature swings. And by being able to provide those animals a more consistent environment, we'll be able to provide them an environment where we're able to control the what they're exposed to, and we're able to keep them healthier. So that's ultimately what our goal is to be able to provide a healthy food supply. And for us on our farm, utilizing those environmentally controlled buildings is how we do that. That's how we implement some of those things and some of those safeguards to make sure those animals are as healthy as they possibly can be.
Panelists, any other comments there? Okay. Corey, why don't you talk to us about branded products? So we hear things like Prime Choice Beef, or Thomas mentioned Smithfield, or Certified Angus Beef. Talk to us a little bit about what those mean and if there's any research behind anything that goes into the specific product.
Okay, absolutely. I would say yes, that there's research that goes into every single kind of product, and I can obviously speak to beef better than I am able to speak to the other products. So my students ask me this a lot, what's the best product? And I always tell them, well, what's your goal? What, you know, do you value taste in your product? Do you value a very lean product? You know, we have different breeds of cattle that can do different things for our beef product. So do you love marbling and you want the juiciest, most tender steak out there? Then there's going to be a branded product for you, probably something like Certified Angus Beef. Is a lean product more what you want than maybe something more along a what we call a continental breed? So I always tell my students, you know, figure out what you like and what you want, and that there's usually a product for you. But I'm not going to sit here and say that one product is better than the other, because we all have different goals, I guess, in what we're eating, or different tastes and that kind of thing. So did I answer that as nicely without saying anything about any certain branded
perfect.
Product?
Okay. You have a lot of options.
She made me kind of nervous with that question.
Panelists, anything else to add there with your respective industries in terms of sourcing product and how that has changed how you do things?
I mean, I think as a pig farmer, whenever we walk into a grocery store and whenever I think about my respective product, I see so many different kinds of labels, and it can be very challenging as a consumer to decide what's right for your family and what works best for your family. And as dietitians, you guys have a challenge too. I mean, providing that insight and that information for your clients and customers. And my wife, she was recently diagnosed with Hashimoto's, so I mean, my understanding of food labels has gone from here to a completely different level now. So, I mean, really respect what you guys do there. But whenever we begin to think about, I mean, pork in general, whenever we walk in and I see labels that say hormone-free pork, I mean, that's always something that really just kind of grinds my gears, because there's always in very little tiny print right above the nutrition label, all pigs are raised without the use of hormones. And so that's always something that's frustrating for me. And from a labeling standpoint, it's very challenging to direct your consumers or your customers in that right direction. But I mean, as farmers, I mean, we're always a great resource for helping identify where some of those places are. I mean, what are some of those more wholesome options? And so, I mean, you have to determine, as Corey said, I mean, the value system you have and establish that within those families. But, I mean, at the same time, utilizing those resources you guys have to better understand, I mean, how those animals are being cared for and what those specific labels might mean.
And there are certain ones like the words prime, choice, select. The USDA has very strict standards on that. That's not something somebody can play with. And if they do, their labeling system is corrected very quickly. But for a while there, it was the wild, wild west in the meat case, because there were words used and phrases and certain slogans that really didn't speak to the truth. And there has been a large clamp down on that, requiring certain standards to be met. And those standards are verified, not necessarily by a meat inspector, but by an inspector with the USDA to ensure that those claims are true and accurate, and they're true and accurate all the time. So,
Matt, we've talked a little bit about what happens in a processing facility and all of the food safety measures are in place. But for all of those of us at home that are worried about food safety and want to make sure we're doing the best we can with the product, what are some practical ways just to ensure food safety?
Well, I mean, as a processor and as a farmer, I can only do so much. You take the final product home, you handle it the way you handle it, and serve it the way you serve it. It basically comes down to a very rudimentary understanding of keep hot foods hot, keep cold foods cold, and keep raw food from cooked food. Because if you do all three of those things, quite frankly, meat inspectors wouldn't need a job because you wouldn't get sick. So, you know, don't use the same plate to put your cooked steak on that you had your raw steak on. Wash your vegetables thoroughly to remove any pathogens that might be on them. And continue to keep track of, you know, what temperature you keep your foods at. If you keep your casserole out on the stove the entire day, it's not going to be 135 degrees, which is the minimum to prevent any pathogen growth. So keeping track of that, and quite frankly, just putting stuff in the fridge as soon as you're done with it, and you're never going to have an issue with any type of foodborne illness by any stretch.
Okay, I think we're going to go ahead and start opening it up to questions here in the audience. If anyone has a question, raise your hand. I'm going to come to you and give you the mic, and we'll let you ask it of the panelists. So,
I have a big mouth. I don't need a mic. But okay, so gene editing, that was something new. I'm older, and all at once I always do classes, but a lot of younger people are asking about gene editing and how much it's going on, and first time I heard it, I went, I have no idea. So if any of you know much about gene editing, please.
So gene editing is an extremely exciting type of technology, and so it's different in the approach where, I mean, it has a multifaceted benefit potentially, where it's not just animal agriculture, it's just not plant-based. I mean, it has a large human implication as well. And the biggest challenge is with utilizing that technology is how it's regulated and how it's implemented. And so as a pig farmer, what that could mean for me. So one of the biggest challenges we have is a certain virus called porcine respiratory and reproductive syndrome. And so it is a virus that afflicts, I mean, about every pig farm across the nation in some way, shape, or form. And so we have, through biosecurity measures and filtering of our farms and different things, we have found ways to, and vaccinations as well, I should say, we have found ways to work around that potential virus. But by being able to potentially utilize gene editing, and you're talking about CRISPR technology. And so to speak about that more specifically, it's whenever you're on your computer, you think about the find function. You have some options there. So, I mean, for me within the pig, I want to find that specific part of the genome that PERS affects or that virus affects. And so we can either change it, we can delete it, or we can completely insert a different gene into that specific pig. And so a PERS resistant pig has been developed. And so what the biggest challenge for me as a pig farmer, and I consider myself a not necessarily a large pig farmer, is, I mean, how it's going to be controlled and regulated, because it has large implications for the health of my animals. If I could eliminate an issue or a challenge like that. I mean, we're providing a healthier product for our consumers. And one of the other greater challenges is that type of technology going to be available to a farmer like me? And what cost is that going to be? But at the same time, there's concerns about that technology and how it can possibly be utilized and things like that. But I think the use of that genetic editing, and if you dismiss it, I think it's almost relatively irresponsible. I mean, I think there's a lot of research still yet to be done on it, how it can be utilized, and as I've specifically talked about how it affects me, it'll affect you guys as much as it will me, because there's a lot of opportunities that this specific type of technology can imply upon all of our lives and benefit them in one way or another.
And just a quick housekeeping note, in your folders there are some fact sheets. I'm sure you saw one specifically that talks about genetics and genetic technology. But at any point, if any of you want more information, any of us here today can help provide a more in-depth analysis on any of these questions. Do you guys have anything to add to Thomas's comment?
I might just add, in the dairy industry particularly, there is a recognized gene. It's not an edited gene. It's just a recognized gene that's called A2. And that naturally is a lower amount of lactose. And we have purposely bred our herd to have A2 genetics throughout. So we have a lower amount of lactose in our milk. That's, you know, a little bit on a different line, but that the genetics are recognized and what the natural tendency and then how you breed your animals to enhance that throughout your herd.
Okay, I'll take the next question. Okay, in the back.
Okay, so this question is more for Thomas. You talked about how you used essential oils and different holistic techniques. What kind of research have you found about that? I know that's an upcoming thing, especially for humans using essential oils and these holistic techniques for health. So just what kind of research have you found, and how do you determine these methods?
So we actually work with a manufacturer out of Northern Illinois called McNess, and so they've been utilizing and developing this type of technology for years. And honestly, whenever we kind of fell upon this by chance, there was a virus that was plaguing the pork industry about 3 or 4 years ago called porcine epidemic diarrhea virus. And so we had talked with some of our farmer friends about some products they were using and their experiences, and there was a few of them that said that they saw some benefits in terms of response to this specific virus if it was introduced to their herd. And so, I mean, at that point in time as a farmer, I mean, we're grasping for straws and looking for ways that we can provide the best care for our animals. And so this was a new tool that we implemented on our farm, and we saw a very positive response. And so, I mean, what we saw in terms of research for us is relatively firsthand. And so, I mean, we're not specifically mixing the essential oils and oregano and chili powder. It comes in a bag and it smells like pizza. And so, I mean, it provides us a different approach. And I mean, and it works for us. It may not work for every farm, but for us, we saw a response within our animals that we care for that was extremely positive. And so, I mean, we've been utilizing this product for 4 years now, and we believe wholeheartedly in what it does for our farm. But I mean, on another farm, it may not have the same level of response, and it may not have the same level of success. But for us, it's been extremely beneficial.
Next question. Come here and then I'll come to you.
Thank you. So this question is for Linda. I heard you and read on your brief about grass-fed, and that your dairy cattle are raised eating grass in the farm. Is that grass also organic, or can you address that issue and why not? And then certainly for the rest of the panelists who feed their animals, about using fewer pesticides.
Okay.
Herbicides as well.
Right. Our farm is not certified organic. We don't use herbicides. We don't use pesticides. We are very vigilant on maintaining our pastures, and so so that we don't have a problem, you know, with those things so much. We have chosen not to be organic. We are in an area that we have a lot of farmers, you know, adjoining ours that might use something. I don't see for us the what that would do for us. I mean, we do grass fed. We don't use those things. We don't you know, but we're not certified organic.
I'll add into that just a little bit in terms of some measures. We are not certified organic either. However, that is not to say that herbicides are just being applied to our pastures like crazy. We've actually even taken some measures. There's been some research done as far as other species you can run on your pastures that will consume things like weeds. And I know the agronomists here in our department would probably be yelling at me for just calling them weeds, but that's the animal scientist in me. Species like sheep and goats, their mouth structure is quite a bit different than cattle. So if you look at like the lip structure of a cow, it's not very flexible. Like we can lift our lip off of our teeth. I cannot. They use their tongue to basically rip the grass and bring it into their mouth. Well, sheep and goats can actually be quite a bit more selective. They can graze down quite a bit tighter. So in other just species of forbs, I should say, appeal to them, don't taste as bitter to them as they do to cattle. So that's actually something we've explored. We've been running some goats with our cattle to help naturally control some of those, what I just call weeds and have much more scientific names and that type of thing. And that's something that, I don't know if you pay attention to the news, but that's something that's really catching on in a lot of parts of the world as far as controlling wildfires, brush that builds up for wildfires. I've even read a story that O'Hare Airport grazes sheep and goats to naturally keep the grass along and weeds along their runways down at a more controllable level. So that is just that's one thing that, although we are not certified organic, we are always looking for ways to not have to use those herbicides for any other reason other than they're just expensive. And so we of course believe that it is better, more sustainable to use species like goats, but also the cost is a factor in that too.
I mean, as a crop or corn and soybean farmer as well, we're always very diligent in how we care for our land, because I mean, it's a legacy for us and it's generational. And so, I mean, we want to care for the land in the same way that our predecessors did, but also leave it in a better place than what we found it for that next generation. I mean, my girls have a long time and my nephews have a long time before they have that opportunity to take over the farm. And we want to make sure those soils are as rich as they were whenever the glacier came through and turned them for us. But whenever we begin to think about herbicide and pesticide use, I mean, we're extremely diligent whenever we do make that decision. One, they're extremely expensive. It's astronomical when you begin to think about the cost and what it would be to spray one field. And so, I mean, we begin to take that into consideration of the crop and how we can provide the best care for that specific crop. But at the same time, we utilize alternative approaches as well, where we plant pollinator habitats. We also use cover crops, microbials, and different things like that to improve soil health and possibly eliminate some of those challenges and reduce the amount of herbicides and pesticides that might be needed if they are. And so, I mean, we're always looking for different ways and different approaches. And I'm not going to stand here and say that one way is better than another, because I don't think it is. I mean, we all have the same level of care for whether we're raising vegetables, corn, soybeans, we're raising animals. I mean, I'm not going to stand here and say one way is better than another, because we all care for what we're doing extremely diligently and, as Linda said, very deliberately.
So this question could be answered by any or all of you, I think, but as a consumer, I mean, I buy my protein products from the supermarket, and I also have bought for years from local, smaller, family-owned retail family farms. what should I, as a consumer, look for or ask for when I'm making a decision? Right now, it's generally word of mouth. You know, my hairdresser says, oh, you need to go to so-and-so and buy from their place. But as I hear you talk, what should I look for to know that they are holding themselves to above the baseline standards, something like the third-party audits, or upping their game on quality, or making sure that their animals are treated humanely? How do I, when I'm assessing whether I want to buy from someplace, what's out there for me to look at or questions to ask to ensure that?
I will tell you this. I can't tell you that because it's completely up to you. Just in the last 2 years, Tyson, one of the largest meat packers in the country, absolutely refuses to buy cattle from people that aren't BQA certified. So they are buying cattle from people that are certified in how an animal is raised and then how it's handled and everything else. So I can guarantee you that it's not as hard as you think. Also, I know if you go to the Illinois Beef Association webpage, they have a list of people that sell freezer beef. So you can call those people, you can buy your beef straight from them. How they sell it, I don't know, but that's completely up to you. Also, you can probably do the same thing with pork, or they know somebody that has pork that they sell it that way as well. So if you wanna buy your meat products that way, you absolutely can. Obviously, if you don't like what you're getting at the store, which, you know, kind of initiates the question sometimes, where do I buy better if you don't like what you're getting? Travel around. Not to put a plug in for me, but there's places like mine where we do sell boxed product as well, because I would have to kill 8 days a week to have enough ribeyes in order to serve the customer demand that I serve. But we also bring animals in, we process them ourselves, and we put that product out front. And we can always steer you in the direction that you want to go. So I don't want to say that smaller is better, but you can definitely get a much more broad viewpoint just asking someone who's involved.
But how do you, for instance, post your certifications and your audits and share that information?
I don't know. At least from a meatpacking standpoint, I don't know that that's public information. Obviously, you can check our health department grade online and see what our health department grade is. We don't grade beef at our facility, so I don't have carcasses stamped in the cooler that say prime or choice or select or anything like that. So it just comes down to buy from who you trust. And if that means you trust it off the grocery store shelves, there's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. And educate yourself. I mean, go online. Look at credible sources and learn what all the phrases and slang, you know, they talk about trigger words, learn what those trigger words are. And then when you go in, you're much better informed instead of hoping that someone can take your hand and get you where you want to go. So.
Hi, my question is for Linda about your product, Extreme Ice. It sounds exciting, but I'm confused. Is it a yogurt, a beverage, a dessert? How do you market it? And is it available in the stores in your area?
Okay. All right. The Extreme Ice is a, right now we're marketing it in a 5-ounce container. And we use our sweet cream whey. When you make cheese, like for instance, we're making and we have 6,000 pounds of milk that we're making cheese from. We'll also have 6,000 pounds of whey. And it makes me think I need a 12,000 pound vat, but I don't, I just need 6,000. And so we use the fluid whey, and the fluid whey then does not give the gritty flavor or the grittiness that oftentimes the powdered whey does, and it doesn't give the aftertaste. So as far as how we market it, we have two different types of Extreme Ice. Now we have our Extreme Ice that I put on your table, and we have our Extreme Ice Pro, and they're made exactly the same. The Extreme Ice Pro goes through the millions of tests to make sure there's no athletically banned substance. There's none of those 280 athletically banned substance in it that the Extreme ice does not go through the athletically band, but they go through all the other testing. Let me see, let me think if I'm getting all your questions. This is a product that, like I said, we developed at our creamery, and as far as we know, there's no other product on the market that's exactly like it. It is a frozen product, and so it's more, I can liken it to a sorbet. It is, there's no artificial anything in it. There's no artificial, there is ascorbic acid for the fruit that's in it, that, you know, is the antioxidant. But other than that, there's no, you know, preservatives or anything. Did I miss a question, part of your question?
Okay, so I use a spoon rather than a straw.
Yes. Yeah, well, if you want to thaw it out, now there is some that, if you come to our creamery, and our creamery is actually open to the public 6 days a week, and we have some extreme ice that we have, like, in a slushy machine that you can sample that's like that. But generally speaking, it's a frozen 5-ounce container.
And where was it marketed?
Well, we're in the St. Louis Metro, and so at this point in time, it's a growing market. But we have, at this point, we're in, like, the Deerburg shopping centers. We're in a growing number of shopping centers. We have marketed to, a year ago, we sold it to the Cardinals baseball team and to the Texas Rangers. And then in January, they made the mandate that all pro athletics and no clubhouse unless it was NSF certified. But we were already on the road to that certification, and we have attained that. So,
okay. Come right here to the middle.
Hi, I also teach here at ISU, so now I have a new contact right across the parking lot from you. Well, this question is for anyone who would like to chime in, but I'm actually teaching right now the federal, state, and local regulations concerning in terms of labeling and some of the words that are used on labels and how some could be misleading because customers aren't equipped maybe to understand all the specific standards and regulations. And one of the things that I oftentimes come up with is I began discussing the organic labeling and how 100% organic and organic and all the other terms aren't the same. And so when I do discuss organic products versus conventional farm products, I do, I'm one of those who's like, who wants to make sure that they understand that one isn't bad or one isn't evil and the other is good. Because when I tell them about organic, they look at me like I have two heads, because I think that they're convinced from marketing, because the marketing aspect labeling, that only organic is good and everything else is evil. You know what I'm saying? So I oftentimes use the example of past surveys that indicate that they had asked consumers, what are your top 10 concerns about the food supply? And pesticides and use of pesticides and herbicides oftentimes in their minds are way up here. And so in actuality, the research indicates that it should be foodborne illness and pesticides down here. So I, you know, if you have any advice on how I can, you know, what kind of resources I can use in order for them to, you know, I guess believe me.
Yeah, the only thing I can think of is some examples of, contamination. And I am not anti-organic by any means. I think that you have to absolutely qualify what you're doing, because I know a few years ago when we had the big spinach, disaster, and there were people all over the United States that got it, it was because it was organically grown. They hadn't tested the, quite frankly, I'm just going to not say this, but the manure that they were using, it contained E. coli, rain, splashed it back up on the leaves, and that was the source of contamination. So just because it says organic doesn't mean that everything's always going to be exactly perfect with it. And so I think that, you know, we need to have an understanding of that, that, you know, you still have to handle it correctly. You still have to do all the things that need to be done, whether you're labeling it organic or you're not. You know, those things don't change.
Any other additions to that question? And I think we'd be able to provide more information as well. We're gonna wrap things up. I know I saw some other hands go up. We will be on the buses. Alan, Joanne, Mike that are in the room are gonna be with us today so we can continue to answer some of these questions. If any of you have cards that have additional questions and wanna bring those to me and let me know what your question is, we'll make sure you get answers as well. I'm gonna have my friend Renee here make some final announcements before we break.